Good morning and welcome to the ninth meeting of 2017 of the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. We have apologies from Finlay Carson. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, can I remind everyone present to ensure their mobile phones are on silent for the duration of the meeting. The first item on the agenda is for the committee to consider whether to take item three in private. Are we all agreed? We are indeed. So we move to the second item on the agenda this morning, which is to hear from an expert panel on the environmental implications for Scotland of the UK leaving the EU. We've been joined this morning by Professor Gavin Little from the University of Stirling, Professor Elisa Morgera from the University of Strathclyde, Professor Colin Reid from the University of Dundee, and Dr. Annalisa Savaresi of the University of Stirling. We're also joined this morning by Bob Ward, the Policy and Communications Director of the Grantham Research Institute on Climate Change and Environment. Good morning, Bob.
Good morning.
Good morning. If you wish to respond to any of the lines of questioning, could you just raise your hand to indicate to me that you want to come in and we'll come to you? Thank you very much for that. Okay, so we move to questions. We will when I find these. Thank you. Can I ask all of the witnesses in turn how a great repeal bill will work for environmental legislation? Who wishes to go first?
I'll start on that. The Great Repeal Bill, which is intended simply to carry over all EU law into domestic UK law, will work very nicely for a big chunk of environmental law because lots of the measures have already been implemented. A lot of EU environmental law has been done through directives which have required implementation within the UK legislation in any case. So the EU layer is almost a sort of extra layer on top of the detailed rules which all exist in UK legislation already. The problem is that that won't cover everything. At the one extreme, there are areas where the law is wholly dependent on EU decision-making, EU structures, EU processes. And in between, there's a huge area where there's a lot of legislation that includes references to EU legislation. The boundaries of things in the UK domestic law are defined, are set by reference to EU directives. And untangling all that is going to be a fairly major exercise.
So if I remember rightly, there's about 650 individual pieces of legislation. How many of those would easily fall within the remit of the Great Repeal Bill?
I have absolutely no idea. And within each individual bit of legislation, there are different bits will have different consequences.
So it's complicated?
It's complicated.
Right. Anyone else wish to come in on that? Elisa Morgera.
Thank you. I may add to the complication. I think one of the interesting features of EU environmental law is that there have been successive generations of pieces of legislation on different sectors, and increasingly those sectors speak to each other. There's been a lot of effort in making sure that nature protection considerations are included in water law, agriculture and fisheries are other examples. We have more or less different levels of success in how much EU environmental law is integrated. But the point is that even small amendments to the existing body of EU environmental law may have trickle-down effects and complications that may be difficult to assess prima facie. I think the other perhaps element of complexity to consider is that in addition to areas where the role of the European Commission is very central and we're clear that there'll be discussions to be had about how that power will be exercised once we are outside of the EU. There are also more subtle roles that the Commission and the EU structure has played, including the issuance of guidance in relation to the implementation of international obligations related to the environment, to which also the UK is bound to. And that may again fall through the cracks. May not be quite immediately apparent how changes in legislation may then be reflected or not in also the lack of guidance. And often it is in the little details of the guidance that decisions about environmental sustainability and sustainable development are made.
Anyone else want to come in?
Can I add to the point that Professor Reid has made? Obviously, in terms of the Great Repeal Bill, the idea is that EU law which is in force in the UK at the time of Brexit, including environmental law, will become domestic law whenever practicable. But there's also, I suppose, the potential in the period that the bill is going through and coming into force for some areas not to be transposed for domestic policy reasons.
As and why?
Well, I suppose that the UK government might take the view that it doesn't want some areas of EU environmental law to be transposed. Now, I don't know what those might be, but I suppose it is potentially possible that that might happen.
Okay. A very small addition to what Elisa already mentioned is that there is a very common assumption that international environmental law obligations will in many ways supplement what are those embedded in EU environmental law. This is not to be taken for granted, especially on the side of enforcement, but more generally, there is the issue that many times EU environmental law are more ambitious than the corresponding international environmental law obligations. Therefore, a careful assessment will have to be made as to the level of which to which the UK / Scotland want to commit moving on.
So can I ask, how much work out with the scope of a Great Repeal Bill may have to be done as a consequence of Brexit? Just to get an idea of the scale.
I think that's very hard to determine. The Great if all the Great Repeal Bill says is that EU law as it stands on a certain date is deemed to be part of UK law, that makes the legislative process very easy. It makes actually working out what that means, and in practice very hard for those coming along, especially because we have to work out, we have to freeze the state of EU law and work out what state it was on a particular day. And that becomes, as I say, particularly difficult where legislation makes reference to EU law. For example, there's no definition of waste in UK waste law. It simply uses the EU definition, the scope of projects that require environmental impact assessment. A lot of those aren't defined. It simply says, by reference to EU law, environmental liability is all phrased. The scope of that is all phrased in terms of things that are covered by other bits of EU law. And that process, thinking through how, particularly going looking into the future, what exactly was the state of EU law on the particular date, which may be changed by subsequent amendment of EU law, subsequent reinterpretation of EU environmental law by the European Court. There's a huge challenge there, even if a shortcut is taken in terms of the legislation itself.
Professor Morgera.
And if I may add, I think it's not just the amount of time, but it's also the range of expertise that will be needed to really understand what we're facing. And I mean, we're here as experts, but I'm sure we all feel that our expertise only covers so much. I mean, within environmental law, we have specialized expertise in climate change and nature protection. But also, I think the challenges of Brexit, and we've all been involved in thinking about this, are about thinking about very new interactions between international law, what the hold is left by EU law, and matters of national, constitutional, and Scots law. So that means that it's not just a matter for environmental lawyers, but it's really a matter for all different legal experts that don't usually work together, have never really addressed these questions before.
I think, as some people suggest, it will take 10 years to complete the disentanglement process from the EU. Is that the kind of time frame we might be talking about in relation to environmental legislation, to clarify everything?
Be a huge challenge to do it in 2 years. What time limit you set, I'm not sure. I was told recently that the Republic of Ireland has only just got rid of its last pre-separation pieces of legislation, the last bits of legislation inherited when it was part of the United Kingdom. There are probably some things that don't necessarily need to be changed, but it can be a long process.
Well, we can leave that in our legacy paper for successor committees to deal with. Thank you for that. Bob Ward, do you want to come in on any of this?
I'm not a legal expert, and I think on climate change it might be one of the easier areas because there is a UK domestic legislation governing emissions reductions and action on climate change adaptation. But it would I would assume that the Great Repeal Bill will also cover things like energy efficiency standards and fuel emission standards that we're currently subject to within the European Union. But as to the details of that, I don't know.
Thank you. Let's move on. Dave Thompson. Stuart, sorry, my apologies.
Can I move on to international obligations? Clearly, we're in uncharted territory here in that no member has ever left the EU. Could I ask you, first of all, about your assessment of, obviously, there's issues around whether we think it's going to be hard Brexit or soft Brexit. It was very much hard political questions. But what is often quoted is whether we could go under the umbrella of the European Economic Area, which clearly still follows some climate change targets. What's your assessment of going down that route as far as there is some understandable background to the EEA, and that obviously include countries like Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland, along with the EU, of course. Who'd like to kick off?
The EEA is not subjected to the same, the EEA member states not subjected to the same rules that apply to all EU member states. As you probably know, if you've seen the brief that I submitted, the issue with the EEA membership is that it allows Scotland or the UK to maintain certain standards without being engaged in their development. Nevertheless, it's a sure advantage in terms of continuity post-Brexit, at least in the sectors of products and services, because this is what the bulk of environmental regulations will address in the context of EU membership. Apologies. So this will not, for example, help in the context of apologies, protected areas. This is not one of the areas that is covered by EEA member states' obligations. In other words, EEA membership will help on some issues, but not on others. In that connection, EEA membership could be desirable from a business perspective because it would allow businesses to continue operating on the same basis in which they are operating now with applicability of EU standards on products and services, which are nevertheless going to be applicable if we want to continue exporting these services and goods to the EU post-Brexit.
Thank you. Bob Ward. Thank you, Arden.
Yeah, I agree with that. The EEA may make the trade of low-carbon goods and services easier than if the UK was outside the EEA, but it wouldn't solve problems like the future of the European Union emissions trading system, where the objection appears to be that the rules governing the system are covered by the European Court of Justice, and Ian Duncan, the Conservative member of the European Parliament, suggested recently that because of that connection, it's likely that the UK will need to extract itself from the emissions trading system. Other relationships that relate to Europe and climate change, again, it's not quite clear that EEA membership would make a difference. If you think about the European Union's joint commitment to the Paris Agreement, the UK has already individually ratified the agreement and could operate outside of the membership of the European Union. It's whether EEA would allow a greater cooperation between the UK and the other member states in the international negotiations, for instance, around the future implementation of Paris, I don't know. And I understand that that is one of the areas that's being examined at the moment by the Department of Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy.
My colleague, Mark Ruska, will be asking more detailed questions at emissions trading, so I'll maybe hold fire until his questions. Would other witnesses like to come on in the back with my question?
to emphasize that the fact that the EIA will not include nature protection legislation or the common agriculture and fisheries policy is also a matter that shouldn't just be looked from an environmental perspective. Very recently, the UN Special Rapporteur on Human Rights and the Environment has clarified the important relevance of nature protection vis-a-vis key human rights, right to life, right to health, food and water. And I think the evidence is that so far the role of the EU has been very positive in raising standards in the UK related to the protection of nature. Of course, those were controversial because that's again an area where, which is very close to national sovereignty, where decisions have to be made about the type of development that we pursue. So I think in that relation, there is a risk, and I remember reading 3 weeks ago on the Financial Times cover story that perhaps the Great Repeal Bill will have to do with diminishing protection of nature with a view to speeding up development. So I think once again, these are questions, the areas that will not covered from being part of the EA are critical, not just from an environmental perspective, but also in terms of the vision for development and sustainable development that one pursues and have human rights implications.
Any of the other witnesses like to add anything at this stage?
Just very briefly on the EU ETS and climate policy, even though I know we're going back to it, it's important to note that EU member states presently implement their commitments under the climate treaties jointly with the EU. So this is a route that would be available in principle to either Scotland or the UK if they were EU members as well, one would expect.
Could I move to the other side of the equation now? I talked about probably a softer Brexit. Let's assume, for argument's sake, there's a hard Brexit agreement and that we effectively have a no deal or revert to World Trade Organization rules. What's the panel's assessment then going down that route as far as the effect that would have on the environment?
I think when we're talking about hard Brexit as a scenario, there will be a number of issues to be taken into account. First of all, as I said already, Britain will remain under great pressure to continue to comply with some EU laws and regulations, even outside of the EU. This is very much the case, for example, in relation to chemicals. As you may well know already, there is a vast amount of literature as to how the EU has shaped the world trade in chemicals by adopting regulations that have to be complied with in order to export to the EU. So this will apply to Britain like everyone else if they want to trade with the EU. So in this connection, hard Brexit would not make much of a difference if we want to continue exporting into that market. The issue is, of course, now we, the UK, and has a voice in the making of these regulations. In the future, it will not. It will just be on the receiving end. And as far as everything else is concerned, one has to distinguish between areas. And this could be quite a long conversation to be had. But in general, I think the fact that the UK will be on its own would enable it to make whatever decisions it decides to make on a host of issues from protected areas to climate change, regardless of EU law and the politics, really.
And, well, for example, to answer my own question, which I'm good at, I mean, state aid rules would no longer apply, which may give a bit more freedom in terms of some negotiation.
Absolutely, and if you think of the energy sector, this may be a welcome novelty. At the same time, still in the same energy sector, you think of the effect that renewable energy obligations has had, for example, for the development of the renewable sector in Scotland. Taking away that element in future may mean that there will no longer be such emphasis on this specific sector moving on after Brexit.
Thank you. Other witnesses? Yeah, Professor Little?
Mm-hmm. I think another aspect of a hard Brexit would be the very definite loss, I think, of the European Union system for the enforcement of international obligations, apart from anything else. And so that, I think, would be a pretty significant issue for us.
You've just predicted my next question, right, which is around that. But I think the issue that concerned me was that the statement by the UK government that the European Court of Justice would there be an opt-out of that? So my question, which you partly covered, is who guards the guards? If we leave Europe, who's going to be responsible for infraction procedures if there's breaches of environmental law? I don't know if Professor Lewis would like to say a little bit more about that.
Well, I suppose that would depend to a very considerable extent on the EU's, the UK's position in terms of the trading relationships and the trading agreements that it had. I think that inevitably, though, what it would mean would be a greater focus on domestic enforcement and ensuring that we had a more robust system of domestic enforcement.
In that scenario, there would be a gap for a new Scottish regulatory body?
I think that's possible. I think there's a range of different ways in which the issue of enforcement could be approached. It might be possible, for example, to think in terms of an ombudsman of some description. There could be an environmental court. Again, these are all issues which would have to be explored. And there's different regulatory models and enforcement models that could be adopted. But I do think that enforcement is going to be one of the key issues for us to have to consider.
Thank you. Yes.
And I think, yeah, this may probably be the biggest threat deriving from Brexit, and particularly a hard Brexit. I mean, on the other hand, existing international obligations on the UK have bearing and also provide opportunities to address this threat. International obligations related to public access to justice in environmental matters could play a role, and actually there has been a trend also in EU law to ensure private enforcement of environmental law. The EU and international oversight have already pushed forward, I think, access to justice in England and Wales and in Scotland, but more can be done. And I think according to those lines, and this is something that could be done in the current legal system, these are opportunities that, you know, exist today. Also questions more generally about transparency and public input into permitting procedures and other decision-making processes. Those may be also ways that are generally seen, I think, from environmental scholarship as ways to ensure checks and balances and to provide additional layers of oversight, as well as additional resources that may not be available to the government to ensure.
That's a very useful point. So what you're saying is, irrespective of a hard Brexit occurring, we don't opt out of our international human rights regulations, and that would come to apply in that state. And presumably issues like the Aarhus Convention would apply as well.
Aarhus Convention, European Convention on Human Rights. But the point I want to make is that there have been issues about the adequacy of current law in the UK about ensuring public access to justice. That may have to do with costs of litigation, availability to bring cases in the public interest. There has been progress, but I understand that, for instance, from the point of view of environmental NGOs, more could be done. So the areas where perhaps more progress could be made to be more, even more in line with existing international obligations should be looked at also from the perspective of the loss of additional international oversight.
That's very useful. Thank you. Would anyone else like to comment, including Bob Ward?
Yeah, can I just... I'll draw attention that a hard Brexit, if it means that we see tariffs, it could make a big difference to the development of low-carbon technologies in the UK. It would, for instance, make it more difficult perhaps to export to the European Union, and it would also affect the imports. Now, you might be able to get the development of a larger UK domestic industry to serve a domestic market in those cases, but it's hard to see that would end up with a better deal for the British consumer, because you won't be having the competitive effect of all the European Union member states as you currently do. And if you look at the trade figures at the moment, that in terms of our exports of low carbon goods, more than half is to the European Union. And in terms of imports, which includes things like components for wind turbines, it's more than three quarters come from the European Union. It would not be easy to then replace that with sources from other countries that we might trade with.
Any further witnesses on this point? Before I move on to my final point, so I'm conscious of time, Kavira.
Point. I think Maurice Golden's got a supplementary.
Yeah, I was wondering if the panel had any views just on the, obviously you've mentioned ICJ and as an enforcement mechanism. And I was interested because if you could draw parallels between national legal provision for enforcement versus the International Court of Justice as an enforcement mechanism, recognising that in Europe we've had, you know, the Gapchikovo-Nagymaris dam dispute between Hungary and Slovakia, which was at the ICJ for the best part of two decades and doesn't seem to represent a speedy enforcement mechanism. So how would that work in a kind of post-Brexit landscape with a kind of national enforcement mechanism versus, you know, a European mechanism tool?
Well, I think it's important to bear in mind that the International Court of Justice and the European Court of Justice do very different things. The International Court of Justice is the main international tribunal in existence and oversees litigation, resolves disputes between states over the interpretation of international law. The European Court of Justice has a very different job. The European Court of Justice is, if you like, the Supreme Court of the European Union, and in that connection, it interprets the law of the European Union, but also it solves disputes that emerge in relation to EU law. In this specific connection, what the European Court of Justice does that will no longer happen post-Brexit is to act upon what the European Commission requires it to do in the context of enforcement. So a member state typically, as you could recently see in the context of air pollution, is not complying with its obligations under EU law. The European Commission decides to bring the said member state before the European Court of Justice on a matter of enforcement. The International Court of Justice could never do this. It's simply beyond its remit. So it would never be a supplement for the European Court of Justice. What we are looking at here is a situation where all European member states have, for the last few decades, been in a situation where the European Court of Justice has performed an unusual role of a watchdog in cooperation with the Commission over the implementation of EU law. The question is, how do you deal with its absence? Because the institutions in this country, like in any other European member states, are used to this oversight, have been held to account, and what will replace this, if anything? There are some who argue that it doesn't need to be replaced. We can safely rely upon existing institutions to do their job. Possibly. It really depends on how they go about supplementing the loss of the enforcement aspect that is embedded into EU governance.
And just to follow up on that, if you take the example of something like the bathing water standards, if the Great Repeal Bill may say, right, we just simply transfer the bathing water standards into domestic law, but how do you actually, when it's discovered that the bathing water standards are not being met, who has the right to go to court or wherever to enforce it? What's the process by doing that? What's the remedy that is provided? Because you can't, you know, it's the government and SEPA would be the bodies that are responsible for actually reaching the target. But if you're claiming they failed, obviously they haven't done it. So you can't rely on the government or SEPA. Is absolutely every citizen going to have the right to come to court? If so, through what process, to what tribunal and so on? Big issues there.
Thank you. Mark Russell's got a supplementary question as well.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. Professor Little, you touched on the potential impact of trade deals on regulation and enforcement. I mean, you'll be aware that, you know, there's considerable concerns about CETA and Vesta state dispute mechanisms within that, and requirements for corporations to be involved in the writing of regulations going forward. I'd just sort of be interested from different views around the panel about how you see the direction of trade deals in the future, whether that has an impact in terms of the production of regulations and their enforcement.
I think that's a very difficult question to answer, because if the UK and Scotland as part of it, presumably, was wholly reliant on WTO-style arrangements, that would... Well, it's very difficult to see where it will go, because it's completely uncharted water for the UK, or for an economy like the UK. And so I'm not really sure I can answer that question in a way which is definitive.
If I may add, I mean, it depends with whom the trade deal will be arranged. I mean, the European Union has started a wave of bilateral trade and investment agreements. They have provisions on environmental regulation cooperation. So there are opportunities there, for instance, to continue to work with the EU on raising environmental standards. There are usually also provisions not to lower environmental standards to attract foreign investment. There usually is no hard enforcement in relation to those environmental provisions. It's rather a system of collaboration and support rather than a punitive system. And this system the EU put in place in opposition to, for instance, what is the practice of the US and other big players who use their trade agreements in different ways. Now, there are also ways in which one can use a hard enforcement edge through trade agreements, again, to raise environmental standards. The US has done so with some countries, for instance, in Latin America, to ensure better implementation of international law. But there are also risks that other provisions in those very complex agreements having to do with creating favorable conditions for investment and trade may pose more subtle threats to the environment. So once again, it's a very complex question. Those agreements are usually very voluminous, and the interaction among their provisions, as well as interaction with international law and the national law of the two countries, are very complicated. They can vary a lot. There are some opportunities, but there are certainly some threats. And I think, once again, a really broad range of expertise is needed to fully appreciate opportunities and risks.
Okay. Dave, thank you,
Kavira. In the evidence which you provided to us, which I might say was very helpful and very thorough, there was a theme that there's maybe a gap in the powers of this Parliament, in that we may require some components of international powers in order to deal with Brexit. I'm not suggesting powers to set up embassies in Paris and Brussels, although some of my colleagues may wish to go down that route, but powers temporarily to have an international component. What's your assessment of that? Is that a valid argument? Is there a gap in the powers that this Parliament has to deal with a post-Brexit Scotland and UK?
Again, one has to distinguish between different issues, in the sense that there are some areas of environmental law and policy where there is a very clear international law / policy element, which after Brexit may well be better dealt with by devolved administrations on their own. One of the examples I gave was that of fisheries. Presuming that post-Brexit, the current constitutional arrangement continues on fisheries, for example, Scotland may find itself at loggerheads with Westminster concerning fisheries policies. So what has happened in the past in connection with this specific issue, for example, in Denmark, has been that the Faroe Islands acquired full competence on fisheries. That is beyond what Scotland presently enjoys under the current constitutional arrangement, which is what gave the Faroe Islands, for example, the power to trigger that, or threaten to trigger that famous Mackerel War with the European Union. So a very small subnational entity challenging even the EU on issues of fisheries policy, because it was in their clear interest to do so. In the present constitutional arrangement, that wouldn't be possible, or rather it would be a matter for Westminster to deal with this rather than Holyrood. There are several assumptions in this hypothesis that I've just drawn, but that was just to give an example of how, post-Brexit, there may be some scope to reconsider the existing constitutional arrangements, at least on some environmental issues, in order for them to be addressed in a way that is in the interest of the Scottish people.
All right. Any other witnesses like to contribute? Yes, Professor Reid.
I think I just add to that, it does, of course, rely partly on what the other parties are happy to put up with, and so on, that the Faroe situation was agreed some time ago when perhaps it wasn't seen as being this. It wasn't seen as creating a precedent that might cause trouble in other parts of Europe. I think nowadays, with such sensitivity on various issues, although it's a good example and it shows that with creativity and willingness you can achieve all sorts of patterns that are different from the standard binary one of the nation state and that's it, actually getting there and getting agreement on various things may not be altogether straightforward.
Any other witnesses like to contribute?
Can I just add to Colin's point there? I mean, it wouldn't just be a case of getting agreement on an international basis. It would also, of course, be a case of getting agreement for a particular configuration within the UK context as well. And clearly that may be controversial too.
Thank you. Bob Ward, do you wish to contribute?
No, I don't think so. The Climate Change Act provides a specific role for the devolved administrations on the main areas of climate change policy. So again, it might be one of those areas where climate change turns out to be easier to deal with under Brexit than many other areas of environmental policy.
Thank you, Kavira.
Just to wrap up this session, you've touched there on perhaps enhancing the powers that are available to the Scottish Parliament. How big a concern is it of the possibility of reverse devolution in some areas where powers could be taken away from the Scottish Parliament? Is that something you've considered?
Yes, it is something, because the EU framework has provided a dampener on fragmentation. It's meant that all the devolved administrations have been able to go their own way, but only so far, and we haven't had to think of anything else in terms of cooperation, willingly or forced, and so on. There will be a question post-Brexit of, well, how much across the UK do we want to have collaboration, cooperation, harmonisation, and how is that going to be achieved? Is it going to be achieved by agreement between the devolved administrations, or will London say that, well, no, actually, we need to have a common UK agricultural policy that will make that make sense, and the only way to guarantee that, or the best way, or the simplest way, is simply to say, well, actually, we decide that the power resides in London.
It's a question that would arise is how high or how low is the bar set?
Yeah, and how much do you think you can achieve through informal collaboration and cooperation? How much do you feel you want to guarantee things?
Okay, right, sorry, Morris Golden.
Just a quick one on that, Professor Reid. Is there not also, there's the legal framework, obviously, so you mentioned previously about definition of waste, but there's also a part where the application of that legal definition is interpreted somewhat differently in Scotland versus England, and in your opinion, would that remain in terms of how the practical implementation, irrespective of what the legal framework there is working from?
So long as we still have three or possibly three and a half, maybe four legal systems within the United Kingdom, depending how you regard the situation in Wales, there's always going to be scope for interpretation. There's a question of at what level do you set the common framework, the common measures, how far down does that go into detail? And we've seen in the EU law system, you've got things from directives that are very widely expressed all the way down to the detailed regulations that nail things in absolute detail, because that's thought to be appropriate to achieve the level of conformity, collaboration, cohesion that's appropriate for those particular subject matters. The same questions will arise between the parts of the United Kingdom in a way that we haven't had to think about, because we know that the EU has provided that cohesion.
Let's move this on. Emma Harper.
you, convener. Good morning, everybody. Professor Reid, in your submission, you wrote that some important EU laws may not necessarily carry over post-Brexit, and you mentioned that the comparative stability of EU environment law and policy, it takes a long time for initiatives to proceed through EU lawmaking processes, but once made, they tend to stick without constant change. So I'm wondering, what implications does leaving the EU have for a stable, certain environmental policy on one hand and a flexible, tailored environmental policy on the other? And do you, I guess all the panel, do you have concerns that might be out with a wider EU environmental framework regarding access to your environment counterparts across the EU?
Start on the general point. You've identified correctly the two sides of the coin, that by having the EU policy has been slow to develop, slow to change. That means it's unresponsive, it's not flexible, it doesn't necessarily cope with local circumstances very well. But on the other hand, it means that people have known where they're going. And when you're talking about major enterprises such as cleaning up the seas, cleaning up rivers, cleaning up air, those aren't things that can be done overnight. They do take long-term cooperation, collaboration between different initiatives, different perspectives, and knowing where you're going is important. It allows different areas of environmental law to tie together. It allows industry and investors to know where they're going. Is, if we do something today, is it going to be effective in 10, 20 years' time, and so on. And that can be lost. There is a tendency of national governments to be swayed for good reasons by short-term political will and so on. Every time, if you take the example of the long-term plan to raise the tax on petrol, it about every second year it got knocked back because there was a sudden short crisis that, you know, inflation was going up or something, and what had seemed like a 20-year plan to reduce our dependence on motorised traffic, you know, standard air pollution from traffic, that long-term plan was completely lost every two or so years because that went. There's a danger that happens. And when you think about the scale of investment that's needed and the upfront investment and capital projects, knowing that what you're doing into the future, having a certainty of planning for forthcoming standards, planning for what's going to happen is really important for industry as well as for government and coordinating environmental policies.
Elisa, Savaresi.
In addition to what Colin just said, I think it's important to remind ourselves that we're here looking at a picture that, very much like that of the European Court of Justice, has become familiar for us, and we take for granted many of the things that the EU has been doing for a long time for its member states. And here I'm talking about its technocratic governance. A lot of the elements of environmental law are designed, crafted, and thought of in Brussels by very specialized bureaucracy that they are endowed with. We may think this is not a good idea from a democratic point of view, but the end result of this is that a lot of what is today environmental law in member states is the result of those decisions that have been made there. How do you go about replacing that? You have, in a sense, to develop capacity. For example, the EU ETS, very good example of a construction that is EU-made. The EU ETS is far from being perfect and has not arguably performed as it should have. Now that you are in charge, how do you replace that? So this is exactly what Colin was talking about. How do we give investors, businesses, the regulatory certainty that they will be operating under center conditions? The EU gave that certainty in a way. How do you make up for its loss now?
Anyone else?
To add, I mean, for how much, of course, EU law is cumbersome, there have been benefits in different member states coming together, exchanging views and building on each other's, also lessons learned. And I think most EU environmental law had flexibilities built in. In some ways, the advantage is there, where there was a clear direction where EU environmental regulation was going, but there were also there were mostly minimum standards in place. So there was always a possibility for member states, under certain circumstances, to go higher and be more ambitious in environmental protection, but within a system that guaranteed a lot of transparency. And I think that transparency is normally not there at the level of member states and national parliaments. I think that's one loss that will come. And this transparency also applies to bilateral trade and investment agreements. We don't really have nearly as much information about EU negotiations on bilateral trade agreements as we have for any other big partner. The other aspect which is to be considered, I think Annalisa has hinted to that, is the pooling of resources that occurred in EU environmental lawmaking and the experiences that have been exchanged and the networks that have been created, not only among regulators, but also enforcers and managers of waters, for instance. Some of those networks may remain available to non-member states and possibly be joined informally. So there are some avenues where continued piggybacking on the pooling of resources at EU level may be explored.
Can I just add on to that as well, that another factor to think about is that in terms of policy making and lawmaking, currently, of course, done primarily at the EU level, when that shifts down to domestic level, there will, in addition to there being issues with resourcing of policy making and lawmaking, there will also be political pressures that are brought to bear in that process. Lobbying, much more intense lobbying than probably is the case at the moment, vested interests. And so it could also be that at a more sort of general level, the issue of the environment becomes far more politicised, and that too is something which may well bear on environmental policy making and lawmaking.
Perhaps around the agricultural sector, where we've already heard phrases like level playing field and gold plating bandied about.
Possibly, and there's also, I suppose, other issues which have been parked really at EU level, such as GMOs.
Absolutely. Bob Ward wants to come in.
Yeah, so with climate change, there are a couple of things to point out on the policymaking front. And it should be recognised that the UK has been a leader within the EU on climate policy. It has been cutting its emissions faster than the average. So if the UK is no longer part of the EU's commitment to its long-term collective goals, such as the commitment to reduce its emissions by 30% by 2030, it's going to be more difficult for the European Union to achieve that without the UK. In addition, the UK has been a proponent of stronger action within the European Union, to some extent counterbalancing those member states that wish to go slower, such as Poland, and without the UK part of that process, I think the EU is going to find it more difficult to go faster. But conversely, the UK, if it is now going to be negotiating in the UN as a single country rather than collectively as the European Union, it's likely to be a less influential player. That's certainly going to be true within climate change, and it may have to look for other groupings. There is within the UN climate change negotiations a new group called the High Ambition Coalition of countries which are were, for instance, pushing for the commitment to limiting the rising global mean surface temperature to only 1.5 degrees. So that might be the future for the UK, but it's hard to see that the UK will be as influential in those international fora alone compared with its role within the European Union.
I think that takes us nicely on to a question that Angus MacDonald wants to ask.
Yes, Convener, following on from the panel's comments, in particular Dr. Savaresi's and Bob Ward's, I'm keen to explore in a bit more detail the issue of nationally determined contributions, which detail the action each state will take to meet the Paris Agreement. Now,
given that EU officials undertake most of the work involved in drafting, compiling and completing NDCs on behalf of all the EU states, I'm curious as to whether there are capacity issues with regard to whether or not the UK has the capacity to complete its own NDC, which it will presumably have to do immediately after Brexit. Is there the capacity there to deal with that over the next 2 years? And are there any safeguards to ensure the UK doesn't backslide on its own specific NDC and also the existing EU one that was signed in 2015?
Okay. Who wants to come in on this? Bob Ward, do you want to kick off?
The UK's domestic target, which is outlined in the fifth carbon budget, is more ambitious than the European Union's collective collective target for 2030. So the UK, now the government, the UK, the Westminster government's currently trying to work out what policies it needs to deliver on that 2030 target in the fifth carbon budget. And that's due to be published at some point this year, we hope, in the Clean Energy Plan, which will lay out in detail what needs to be done. I would imagine that that information will be more than sufficient to provide the details for a UK nationally determined contribution, which would need to be submitted at the point when the UK decides to be a separate entity with regard to the Paris Agreement, rather than as a as part of the European Union member state. So now on the capacity issue, the UK's has provided many of the lead negotiators in the European Union, in the UN negotiations, particularly Pete Betts has played a strong role. So there is expertise there. I would say, though, that the big problem at the moment, and one of the main reasons why the Clean Energy Plan has been delayed, is the amount of time that's being spent on trying to work out what Brexit means. It's causing an enormous distraction in many of the Westminster government departments, and is limiting the ability to make progress on these other commitments.
I suppose as well the issue of how high a priority this is in the grand scheme of things comes into play.
Yes. Well, I mean, the discussions going on about climate policy in the Department for Business, Energy and Industrial Strategy are also closely linked to broader discussions about the energy union and issues such as what about interconnectors for the UK with other EU and non-EU members, non-EU states. So it's a complicated set of issues, but the UK at least has the domestic legislation in the 2000 Climate Change Act, which should not mean a big dislocation if we are extracting ourselves from the joint negotiating partnership with the other European Union member states.
Dr. Savaresi.
There are a number of things that could be said about NDCs, but I try to keep this brief and as untechnical as possible. NDCs are new. They are a very recent creation in the context of international climate law and policy. So there is very limited experience with them. What has happened so far for EU member states is that the Brussels bureaucrats have taken care of working out a collective NDC for the European Union and its member states. In this context, I've also worked out what sort of targets will be assigned under EU law to each EU member state. So moving out from this architecture will entail that the UK will have to submit its own NDC, as it has already been mentioned. It will not be possible to backslide on whatever was promised before that point, but that shouldn't be a problem because, as it was already observed, domestic UK policies are more ambitious than those the targets are envisioned in EU law. So I wouldn't be concerned about that. What could be an issue in the context of the UK NDC is how the NDC is prepared. In other words, there is no precedent for this. It has never been done before. So what will be the role of devolved administrations in the preparation of the NDC? And most important, I think, for Scotland would be what will be, for example, the role of renewable energy in that context, what kind of targets, if any, will be embedded in that. So there will be a conversation, I think, to be had, for example, on this issue, as well as any other that is touched upon in the NDC. It's important to note that there are no rules presently on what NDC should say. There's no NDC template because the parties could not work it out in advance of the Paris Agreement's adoption. So they will come up with a template in the next few years. And when that is available, of course, it will be a matter to stick to that template when it's available.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay. Right, thank you for that. Alexander Burnett.
Thank you. Moving on from sort of bureaucracy of integrating environmental policy challenges. Around funding, could you comment around the funding implications of leaving the EU, particularly given that we're currently a net contributor?
Don't know the details of the funding. I concentrated on the legal side. I know that the funding arrangements are complicated because there are the various programmes which tie into EU measures and programmes. How far they will, it'll obviously be a domestic policy decision, how far we replicate those, which could obviously go up or down in particular areas. The agriculture area has obviously been identified as a huge area where there are financial implications in the details of the schemes and the overall framework of the financial schemes that can operate. There are, throughout the EU environmental law, there are odd bits and pieces that have financial implications. For example, charging for water services and so on is embedded in the water framework directive, but that's all of those details, I'm afraid, are way beyond me in terms of detailed expertise.
I'm also not an expert, but I think there are perhaps two sets of considerations to bear in mind. So the first is, internally, what will be the amounts of funding that will be made available for continued, for instance, integration of environmental issues into the agriculture and fisheries policy. But it's not just a question of amount, it's also a question of rules. And at the moment, there are particular rules related to funding going to farmers or fishermen that either bind them or encourage them to take a more, let's say, ecosystem stewardship approach. Now, those rules could change, and funding could really be a huge factor in whether or not our productive sectors take an environmentally sustainable approach or not. The other question is whether the UK outside of the EU could still participate in funding schemes that the EU manages. There are different, I think there are some experiences there. There are some lessons learned, for instance, looking at the question of also research funding. Negotiations can take some creative routes. So again, it may be a question of both looking at precedents, but also perhaps thinking about ways in which agreement can be found with the EU for some continued participation in funding schemes.
What Elisa just said, it's interesting, for example, to note what EEA members do presently. They all have different arrangements in relation to funding. So it will be down to negotiations, really, what specific elements the UK and or Scotland may want to adhere to post-Brexit, research only, development only, both. It will be really up for grabs.
Really wish to add much more than that. I mean, I think that the issue of funding is predominantly a political one. It's a policy issue rather than a legal issue, which is what we would speak to.
Okay. Jenny Goldruth.
Meener, and good morning to the panel. Professor Little, in your written submission, you talk about, in the event of a hard Brexit, how that could impact upon environmental policy and lawmaking in terms of the loss with regard to resources and expertise in Scotland. And you state that this may result over time in Scottish and UK environmental policy and lawmaking becoming more piecemeal, incremental, minimalist and reactive. So there's obviously an issue here in terms of capacity. I'd just like to ask the panel more broadly, do we have that capacity in Scotland at the moment in terms of environmental resources and expertise?
I'm not sure that the UK has it. And I think that it will be a struggle for both Scotland and the UK to try and replicate the level of expertise and the capacity that the institutions of the EU have. The comments that I made in my paper, I mean, I think that one thing that I would want to add to them is that I think that, you know, it was alluded to the fact that it's unlikely that environmental issues are going to be a priority in the context of everything that's happening. And I think that what is likely to happen in the event of a hard Brexit is that there will be a gradual process. I don't see things happening in an immediate sense. So we're talking, you know, the medium to long term. What you'll see is an uncoupling of provision, substantive provision, in some areas in Scotland from the rest of the EU. And I think, too, if one looks at the history of environmental law in Scotland and the UK, what you might call the long 19th century of environmental law or public health law in Scotland, we did see a pattern of lawmaking and policymaking which was generally ad hoc, pretty slow, incremental. Now, it's not necessarily the case that, given the transnational nature of much modern environmental law, that would be the case in a post-Brexit situation. But it's possible that that might reflect a national dynamic, if you like, within Scotland and within the UK on environmental issues.
Are outside the EU or within the EEA who have built up the capacity to track European directives and legislation and implement them. And if there are successful models we can look at there.
I think if you put in terms of to track the EU directives, that's the easy way out. That's the way out that says, well, here's an important area, we recognise something must be done in it, we look around and we take something off the shelf, the EU model off the shelf, but that may or may not be what is wanted in a post-Brexit UK or a post-Brexit Scotland, where the whole idea is that you design your own policy to design your own, you know, to fit your own particular needs and circumstances. I think the sheer scale, when you look at the number of things that the EU does on environmental area in any given year, you can go through some of them would be unnecessary and so on, but actually a lot of them are things that are worthwhile doing, and they're going to be hard, and there's no way in which Scotland, Northern Ireland, Wales, England by themselves can do all of those. So you come back to this idea of some form of cooperation, cohesion at the UK level, beyond the UK, with some or all of the member states of the EU, EEA, and so on. Are we allowed to have some sort of associate membership of the various professional and other collaborations that operate so we can continue to pool experience and so on. I don't have details of it, but I'm told that de facto in some areas in the EU, it's recognised that different member states take the lead on it. So you don't actually, although all member states are meant to be engaging equally with things, well, you leave that to the Dutch or you do this so and so, and there may be areas where we suddenly find that we have a lack of experience, but again, that's the internal workings of the government departments. You really have to ask them what they think about it.
Can I follow up on a point that Professor Reid has made there on the issue of tracking EU legislation? In the Scottish context, that may prove problematic if you have UK strategic legislation which is contrary to, this is post-Brexit UK legislation, which is contrary to EU law.
Equivalence is going to be vital in terms of trade, whatever trade deal is established. equivalence over a large number of environmental standards will be important.
One would think so, but as was mentioned earlier, there could well be some areas where that would not be the case, and where states would have a greater degree of national discretion.
I guess that scenario where you would be pulling something off the EU shelf and seeking to implement it is where the threat of lobbying and pressure comes in, where groups are saying to government, you don't have to do this and it doesn't suit us for you to do it. And I suppose that's where we get into the territory we touched on earlier. Yeah. Okay.
And of the interlinkages, and that's where also the pooling of resources at EU level was helpful. So implications across different ranges of international negotiations having to do with the law of the sea as opposed to biodiversity and water, trade and investment at different levels. I mean, all these things are really very much linked, and you know, even pulling just one thread may unravel a lot of other areas. So that it's not just a question of tracking EU environmental law, but also understanding why certain developments occur at EU level in relation to developments perhaps in other areas.
Dr. Savaresi.
Very briefly, and on a purely anecdotal basis, I know for a fact that in the context of Norway, for example, they have developed capacity in order to just do that, keep track and keep tabs of EU law, because this is what they have to do as EEA members, and not even on all issues. But this is an enormous bureaucratic undertaking in the sense that not being party to those negotiations and those deliberations means that they are really very much in the darkness many times as to why some issues were addressed the way we were addressed. So it's definitely even harder on the outside to keep tabs of EU law and regulations. At the same time, and this may sound overly optimistic, but it's important to remind ourselves that the EU has broken the path on so many environmental issues. For example, you may be aware that post-2020, the EU is coming up with a comprehensive plan for reducing emissions from land uses, which is unprecedented. Nobody else has done it before. Everybody's looking at what the EU is doing. And it's very much like when the EU ETS was drawn up. Nobody had done it before. Everyone wanted to learn from the EU, and the EU has learned by error, actually, as it happens. But this is just to say these very ambitious designs that have been drawn up in the context of the EU will be out of reach, I think. For the time being, what realistically the UK will have to do is to build capacity just to cope with the present level of regulation and to keep tabs of whatever EU laws they have to implement because of the trade issues that you mentioned, and then move on to the next level once they have managed to build the capacity that we would need.
David Stewart wants to come in here.
I've got more observation than question, but clearly the witnesses will know that the EU itself also relies on other bodies. For example, in codes of practice for food production, they rely on the Codex Alimentarius, which in turn relates to World Trade Organization. So there is at one level, there is a life out with the EU, much as obviously personally I'm very enthusiastic of the work that's done, that they themselves rely on world experts to give advice on food production.
Yes, absolutely. The EU doesn't do anything, everything itself. That would be impossible in the very global world we live in. Everything is so interconnected. What I mean to say with the example of land uses is that in many areas like chemicals and so on, the EU has come up with new tools to govern environmental issues that have attracted a lot of attention and have become sort of a benchmark internationally for good governance, or at least pioneering governance. Now, outside of that framework, it would not be impossible. I'm just saying it will probably take time before the UK is up to speed on these issues.
And I think what we see also with the EU is that efforts in advancing internal EU environmental law are linked to efforts in having influence on those other international bodies that provide standards and complement. So there is a link between what it's done in terms of EU environmental law, what the EU does as a negotiator in other international organizations, as well as what then the EU does bilaterally with its partners, be that Japan, Canada, the US, or South Africa. So all of that, I think, in time has become much more strategic, the use of these different powers that the EU has as a whole, and again, being out of EU environmental lawmaking, being out of EU negotiating teams mean that, again, those strategic approaches to regulation that grows from internal to international and transnational, it'll be very difficult to affect, to make an impact on those or propose something different. Being a pioneer also means having the advantage of being a first mover, being seen as a model, and having others collaborating or following an example.
Moving on, Claudia Beamish.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I'd like to explore with you in a bit more detail the issue around the opportunities to try and be positive at the moment for better integration of environmental policy and climate change policy with other policy areas such as agriculture, fisheries, rural or land use, and also well-being and sustainability. So I would like to start just by highlighting something from the Strathclyde Centre for Environmental Law and Governance submission and quote that the comment that Scotland could develop a system of integrated regulation and financial support for ecosystem stewardship by farmers that is more ambitious from an environmental perspective than in the EU. And that goes on to refer to ecosystem services and those issues. So I wonder if we could start perhaps with yourself, Professor Morgera.
Yes, thank you very much. I mean, I think one of the advantages of the EU and EU environmental lawmaking being so transparent is that one can point quite clearly the finger on shortcomings. And I think both the EU Common Agricultural Policy and the Common Fisheries Policies have been, for a long time, have not necessarily performed to at least to the expectations of environmental NGOs and other stakeholders. There has been progress, but I think there are still clear areas where the EU is not necessarily has not devised policies that fully integrate environmental concerns or sufficiently effectively integrate environmental concerns in those areas. There are particular new concepts which actually the EU supports internationally, such as ecosystem services or, for instance, international obligations related to ecosystem restorations that don't quite find either yet place or systematic support in EU policies. So there are opportunities there for, while remaining perhaps in line with certain approaches to do better, the question there is whether there is political will, whether there will be leeway perhaps for devolved administrations that have more an interest in going in that direction to pursue that direction. And then of course there is the question of the funding and whether funding will be there, particularly I think for agriculture and fisheries to support those farmers and fishermen who will take the quite burdensome ecosystem stewardship role on to be supported and to be not put at a disadvantage compared to other approaches in that productive sector.
Thank you. Are there other comments from other panel members?
I think the statement is a great opportunity to start again. You know, we could start completely afresh in thinking, what do we want our countryside to be providing? Do we want people to be living there at all? If we want them to be living there, what are they doing? Are they being productive? Are they making productive in a free market system? Or are we going to pay them for different things? If so, is it for agricultural production? Is it for landscape? Is it for environment? How important is food security in all of these issues? All of these things, in a sense, we haven't really had to think about hard for several decades, now are absolutely on the table and have to be thought of. But they have to be thought of at the same time as we're coping with all the disruption from coping with Brexit, all the carrying over of existing law, simply to make sure that something operates in the first place. In a sense, it's a real problem that everything comes at once. The big opportunities come at the same time as you're struggling to cope with just keeping things ticking over.
Thank you. Yes.
Another area that comes to mind, and where Scotland has actually led the way, is that of community energy. that is now becoming an issue in the EU for those who have seen the draft Renewable Energy Directive post-2020. There is actually a mention of this issue, but Scotland is already there. And everybody, I came last week from a meeting in Finland where everybody was asking about the Scottish experience with community energy. So there is a lot more space now for Scotland and the UK to pursue whatever policies they intend to pursue on this specific issue beyond the EU.
Thank you. And could I bring you in, please, Bob Ward, in relation to the question of the integration of climate change policy, which we, in many ways, are very proud of in Scotland and the UK. Just in terms of going forward this week, as people will know, we have the debate on the climate change plan and the continuation of integration post-Brexit. I'd value some comments on.
Yes. Well, some of the key areas have already been highlighted. In particular, the Common Agricultural Policy since 2013 has tried to create a priority for increasing the resilience to the impacts of climate change in EU farming practice. One would hope that the UK will, in whatever replaces the Common Agricultural Policy, will similarly place a high priority on that and also on reducing emissions in agriculture. Much of UK policy up till now has focused on the power sector for reducing emissions, and we've been very successful, but the really difficult stuff that we now face, certainly reaching our 2030 targets and the fifth carbon budget, is going to be around heating and around transport. And we can certainly do a lot domestically within the UK to promote that, but it's going to be very, very difficult. I would like to flag up, I mean, I must apologise that I'm not an expert on the Scottish aspects of climate change policy, but it is of concern that that DEFRA has not done a very good job in England, in my opinion, of raising the profile of climate change risks and of the need to adapt to them. And it's been very much muted, partly because its department has been pared back and they haven't had the staff to implement these policies. But it has to be a priority right across the UK for all the devolved administrations and Westminster to improve the incorporation of climate change adaptation within a lot of existing policy, particularly around flooding policy. That needs to take account of the fact that we are seeing rising sea levels, which are increasing the risk of coastal flooding, and we're seeing heavier rainfall, which is increasing the risk of river flooding and surface water flooding. And it's not always obvious that that's being properly taken into account at the moment in terms of our forward planning.
Thank you. Could I ask the panel more broadly, if there's not more broadly, but actually specifically, but to move on to the integration of marine policy with fisheries and other uses of our marine environment in relation to the Birds and Habitat Directive and concerns about that in the future, and also marine protected areas. But any other comments that the panel may have?
In some ways, the discussion about common fisheries policy can be related to the common agricultural policy. I mean, the EU has done some progress in integrating, perhaps less progress in fisheries than in agriculture, but there's a lot that could be done better. At the same time, I think the marine environment is where we have significant layers of international law and structures in place, so perhaps leeway, in some way, we have less leeway than in the agricultural sector. It's an area where also I think internationally we're lagging behind. I mean, ensuring protection of the environment in the marine context, creating marine protected areas and engaging in sustainable fisheries, they're global challenges. And there is much less experience and understanding than we have about terrestrial protection. So there are, again, there are opportunities there, but there is also, I think, it's a sector where it's very difficult to, it's not impossible, almost impossible to go alone. There's a lot of need for cooperation. There's shared stocks. There are global impacts that affect different areas. So in some ways, it's a process where one can be a leader, but really very much in cooperation in regional, sectoral organizations, as well as international processes.
Thank you. Yes.
Just to add, I very much endorse that final point about the fact it's not something you can do it yourself. Two other different points. One, it's an area where within the United Kingdom, the jurisdictional issues become particularly important about what is UK, what's Scottish, Northern Ireland, and so on. The other point is that it's perhaps a good example of an area where the absence of the EU enforcement measures may be present. If we are not designating enough areas as special areas of conservation in the marine area, inside the EU, the Commission will investigate people who complain, and there's a possibility of action being taken against the United Kingdom to make sure it does do enough in that area. Once you're out with the EU, what's the process? Who calls the government to account if we're not living up to the targets?
Thank you. And finally, are there any examples that the panel can highlight in other countries of very effective integration of environmental climate change and policies such as agriculture or land use, or any of the topics we've touched on? Within or outside the EU, any good examples? Country focused.
On land uses, this is very much a new story in the sense that the Paris Agreement has changed the game a little bit, and this means that states are moving in this sector more slowly than they have in other sectors. This is where the EU experience is so interesting and why everybody is so interested in seeing what they're doing, simply because the way international obligations were crafted before was not an incentive for states to take aggressive action in this specific sector. So the story needs to be told yet about mitigation in the land sector. A lot of attention has been put, of course, on reduced deforestation in the tropics, but this is not what is at issue here. I think in terms of fisheries, this example is very well showcased, but Norway seems to be the leader to look up to in terms of sustainable fisheries management. So we have here a good example of an EEA member state that does not do what the EU does and has managed to achieve success in this very tricky area. One of the very few good examples, I have to say, because fisheries is a very difficult issue for all states. And there is a lot of thinking to be done, and this is an area where the UK on its own could potentially make a difference, bearing in mind that there are international obligations the UK would have to abide to even outside of the EU.
I mean, there are international processes that are exactly trying to do that, to identify good practices. I mean, just this December 2016, 196 parties to the UN Convention on Biological Diversity have been discussing their obligations related to mainstreaming biodiversity in fisheries, agriculture, and tourism. That also has to do with ecosystem-based approaches to climate change adaptation and mitigation. But the jury is still out. I mean, there is the obligations have existed since the 90s. We haven't necessarily made a lot of progress. We need to bring together examples where things have worked. And different international organizations will try and pull that information together over the next biennium. So the FAO, I think, has been mandated to provide experiences and tools related to mainstreaming of biodiversity in the fisheries sectors. So there are ongoing processes, international ones, that may provide food for thought for what the UK and Scotland may wish to do. But at the same time, I think one has to be aware that not things that may work somewhere may not work elsewhere, and there may be practices here that may be helpfully also shared in that context with a view to compare experiences and find the right approach.
Okay, moving on to something we've touched on earlier, but we'll deal with some more detail now, the EU Emissions Trading Scheme. Mark Roscoe.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I think we've already had some comments on the ETS in relation to policing, I think, and the role of the European Court of Justice and also capacity issues as well. Perhaps we could just go around the panel and get some more thoughts on what you see as the most likely outcome here. I mean, do you see us remaining within the European ETS? And if we're not to remain within that, then how do we either link to it or create something as good as, if not better, than the ETS going forward?
Now, as I mentioned in my submission, I think pulling out of the EU ETS would be best done when the end of the present period is over, which is 2021. So that would be the ideal time to unplug from the EU ETS should the UK decide to do so. But why do I say that? Because there are cycles in the EU ETS, so the idea of pulling out at the end of a present cycle would be the least painful option for those installations that own allowances, and there it could be possible to address the technical issues, possibly even compensation issues that need to be addressed in that context. That would also be a good opportunity to work out what to do with these installations after 2021. Because these are the heaviest polluters, these are the largest polluters, so they will have to be regulated in a stringent way to reduce their emissions moving on. The EU ETS is not the only option. There are other options that could be pursued, a UK ETS or carbon tax. There are so many policy tools and regulatory tools that could be deployed. The EU ETS not necessarily is the best. It has had its problems. The EU is going to carry on with it post-2020. There's no doubt about that. And that regulatory certainty is an asset for investors in this sector. But having said that, for the UK after Brexit, this is not necessarily the best option. So it would be a matter for the UK to decide what they want to do in this sector. But for sure, something will need to be done and something will have to be in place by 2021.
I think my view is I'm happy that other people are a lot more expert on the subject than I am. So I'm happy just to
come in.
Yeah, so there are pros and cons to the UK leaving the EU ETS. It's certainly true that it's better for your companies to be inside a large emissions trading system than inside a small one, because the opportunity then to buy permits and sell permits is greater, and you're more likely to have a stable price over that period. If the UK does leave the ETS, there will be significant costs associated with extracting itself. Those are costs that no doubt will have to be passed on to consumers. And then there will be costs of then setting up whatever would replace it. On the whole, leaving the ETS is less of a good idea than staying in. If we do leave, then it's an opportunity to maybe design something that functions better than the EU ETS. It has been hampered in recent years by a structural flaw that meant that it had rules for dealing with cases where the price spiked, but not where it dropped. And hence we've had this extended period of very low carbon prices, which have undermined future investment in low carbon alternatives. the Westminster government has attempted to address this through carbon price support rate, which has added £18 a tonne on top, but it then immediately undid much of the good of that by freezing it instead of continuing to increase it. So the UK would have options, and there are, again, trade-offs between whether you want an emissions trading system in the UK, which then has some sort of relationship with the EU ETS. The advantage of emissions trading system is that it sets a cap. You know what you're going to reduce emissions to. You don't know what the price of carbon will be. Equally, if you set a carbon tax, you know what the carbon price is, but you don't know what emissions reduction you will get as a result. So in general, economists think that emissions trading systems tend to push towards the most efficient savings of emissions, because the trading system allows you to, for instance, go to those parts of the system where reductions in emissions are cheaper. But on the other hand, carbon taxes can be administratively easier to use implement. So my guess is that if we are going down the route of extracting ourselves from the ETS, we will need to look at what makes the biggest sense in terms of our current system. And at the moment, it's worth remembering that the traded sector covered by the emissions trading system only accounts for 40% of the UK's emissions, roughly. And how we, in an ideal world, you would want a strong, uniform carbon price right across the economy in order to get the most cost-effective emissions reductions.
Sorry, can I just pick up on that, Bob Ward? Forgive me if I've got this wrong, but is it not the case if the UK stayed in the ETS as some sort of associate member in the midst of a drive to reduce the cap, it would have no voting rights around that? So therefore, it would be part of a policy it had no input to shaping.
That's certainly my understanding, although you cannot... The question is how much influence the UK currently has. The UK wanted a more ambitious reform of the ETS, and we ended up with a rather watered down version by comparison. So it's certainly true that if you're a member of the of an emissions trading system, you want to play a role in determining its rules. And I would suspect that it becomes a trade-off. Are you better off being in a trading system which is likely to be more cost effective for your companies because the trading of permits is offers you more options? Or would you rather be in a system where you had greater control over the rules, but that the costs overall might be larger for compliance?
Thank you. Apologies to Mark Roscoe. Carol.
Just sort of further to that, I mean, Where do you see reform of the ETS going then beyond 2020? I mean, what kind of rules, as the convener was mentioning there, are we likely to have post 2020? What kind of flavour of ETS are we going to have going forward?
Well, the sorry, is this for me or
for you both?
Please go ahead, Bob.
Please go ahead, Bob. Yeah.
Okay. Well, the problem for the, I mean, you can look at the low carbon price from two points of view. You can argue that it's meant our emissions have been cheaper to reduce than we would otherwise have expected. But it really is a problem that the price has been so low for so long, because many companies now are not expecting a high future carbon price as a result of the ETS, and re-establishing a credibility of a strong price in the future and the expectation of a price in the future will need to be a priority for the post-2020 phases of the ETS, which the easiest way is by setting more ambitious caps. There are also the question of what we do around other, around the non-traded sector. We have the aviation sector, which is slowly moving towards coming up with its own scheme, which means that it hasn't been included in the ETS as it has been. But I think that a strong price signal is absolutely fundamental to driving the investment that you will need in low carbon technologies. And the UK has tentatively gone that down that route through the carbon price support rate, although that still only adds a very small amount. My guess is that we are probably we would need a carbon price of about no less than 50 pounds a ton going forward and higher if you're going to be serious about meeting the Paris targets. And that doesn't look likely at the moment in the ETS. The way in which they handled the reform has also tended to undermine confidence of companies, because the ETS, the more that policymakers intervene in the operation of a carbon pricing system, the more it undermines the confidence of companies that the rules are going to stay the same and that they can plan for the future. So you're kind of caught there. You want more or less to leave the system to operate, but leaving it with structural flaws in it has its own consequences as well.
Just to add to what was just said, the European Commission has made its proposals for the reform of EU ETS post 2020. Whether these will be welcomed or not and how they will be pan out in practice remains to be seen. But the great focus there, as it was just mentioned, was that of ensuring that we get some kind of stability in the price and a more robust price for CO2. Now, we know for sure what will not be included, and we know the land use sector will not be included, so there will be no effort in moving towards that universal EU ETS that Bob was mentioning a few minutes ago. There were very good reasons why that was made as a decision, and I think it's in itself a good decision, especially in the context of a system that has still quite a few teething problems, even in the context of a very homogeneous sector where measuring emissions is actually fairly easy. So the expansion towards other sectors that are less heavily regulated as activities and therefore where measuring emissions is harder, it's trickier and certainly should be considered only when we have a robust, well-performing emission trading scheme, where no surprises can arise of, you know, hot air and all the other technical jargon that is used to depict the fact that we are actually paying for emissions reductions that are not taking place. So this is where the EU ETS is. Talking about technicalities and arrangements, it was already mentioned the fact that even though we are not members of EU, EA member states have opted to actually join the EU ETS, and therefore they have their own ETS that are, well, they are part of the EU ETS, but they have installations in their own jurisdiction that are part of the system. This could be an option for the UK moving on, but as it was mentioned, the problem with that is that you would not have a say in how the rules are drafted, and this is always the issue with EEA membership. You are part of a regulatory system that you have no control over. But the point that Bob made is also very fair. There is an issue there with how much every EU member state actually controls the UETS. There is a widespread dissatisfaction with the UETS at the same time. It has been very hard to fix it so far.
Okay. You're happy with that, Mark? Okay, thank you. Kate Forbes.
Thank you very much. So we've covered an enormous amount of ground this morning, and as we sort of move towards the end, What are the lessons that each of you would identify that we could learn from other countries for either specific environmental issues or for environmental policy as a whole?
You've stumped them.
Scenario, I don't think we can have very easy precedents or examples to look at. I think probably the biggest challenge, this raises questions that are unprecedented, and it forces us to look at even very well-known areas of environmental law with very different eyes. I myself have worked on some of these issues, and I found myself reaching very different conclusions now that I think of Brexit. I think that there are more considerations that should be looked at. So the fact that we need to look, I think, at environmental law as a whole, not just picking priorities, because that can be very dangerous. So of course, climate change is very visible, but I think it is intimately connected to what we do with biodiversity and water and environmental impact assessment. We need to look at the environment as part of a broader sustainable development strategy and looking at questions of trade, investment, human rights, human health. And I think what, to me, the biggest lesson is that we need to work much more across disciplines and across expertise to really understand how, as we were saying earlier, pulling one thread may mean unraveling many other things we're trying to address. I don't think there's any clear example of somebody that has excelled in integrating the environment in different sectors. These are ongoing challenges. So I think it's, I don't think there are any simple or one examples that we can look at.
As a different way of avoiding the question, I think I'd say that so much depends on the wider background, that simply in the legal side, if you take the simple example of nature conservation, in the United States, the attitudes of what the landowner can do on their own land are so different from what they are in Europe that the approach that we have of sites of special scientific interest, so on and so forth, just doesn't work. They doesn't exist in the same way. And those differences pervade all the systems. The legal structures, the legal ideas, likewise the way in which the economy works. Is the economy driven by small businesses, larger businesses? What's important in relation to the trade-offs between food security, food production, profit, and so on? So the looking around the world is always very dangerous because you can see particular things that look wonderful, but when you try and transplant them, there can be huge problems because in so many ways they're a product, they work in their own particular context.
Okay. It's been interesting, it's been fascinating this morning hearing your evidence. One of the things that struck me is that there's been little or no disagreement across the panel, across the subject matters we've covered. And I just wonder, is that the case across wider academia? And if it is, what role can academia play in assisting the UK and Scottish governments to identify the risks and opportunities that are there and to plot a way forward? I mean, are you aware of any approaches to the sector from either of the governments seeking access to your expertise?
As you may know, I coordinated for SUN a report that was published before Christmas on the environmental impact of Brexit in Scotland. And in fact, all of our panelists, except for Bob, I'm afraid, contributed to this report. So on the back of that report, we did have a meeting a couple of weeks ago with members of this personnel from the Scottish government seeking our expertise, and the idea would be moving forward to engage in a sustained dialogue with them, because there's so much expertise, fortunately, in Scotland on environmental law, but as Elisa has explained, we're also fairly specialised, so it does make sense to address issue by issue and engage with us in a conversation moving forward, simply because this is what we do, this is what we know, but at the same time, there is so much that nobody really knows in relation to Brexit, so it makes sense to bring our heads together and try and figure out what we should do or could do.
Absolutely. Anyone else? Professor Reid?
Apparent unanimity might be because at this stage we're still identifying the challenges rather than actually producing the solutions. When you get forward to work out what is the best way of dealing with these challenges, you may find that different people have different views.
Bob Ward.
Yeah, I, I think that academia has a big role to play in making sure that that Brexit and in the environment is not just about regulation. And this is a particularly crucial point on climate change. There are some within the English national political system who would portray climate change as simply a drag on economic growth, a cost to be minimized. That's a profoundly narrow and mistaken point of view, and I'm glad to say that Scotland seems to have a slightly more enlightened view. But the trade opportunities are going to be there. We have seen with the Paris Agreement a big international policy driver which will drive the development of low carbon goods and services across the world. And most of the world is outside of the European Union. If the UK wants to take advantage of trade deals outside the European Union and build them up, it ought to be looking in particular at the low carbon goods and services sector. And I think that the academia needs to help the political, those in the devolved administrations and in Westminster to understand this point. It's a huge trade opportunity. The UK has very considerable comparative advantages in many low carbon technologies, and as well as a world-class science base working in many areas of low carbon R&D. And we need to be sure that this is not just portrayed as a regulation issue. This is really about trade opportunities driven by the Paris Agreement.
Professor Morgera.
Just to say that I think, I mean, we're all part of an informal network, I think, of environmental lawyers in Scotland. We're also most of us, I think, part of this Scottish network on EU law. So I think there is willingness in academia to collaborate. What I think has been perhaps challenging until now has been to collaborate in an effective way, partly because the timeframes are very tight, and it really needs for us to work much more across the board than we have done. But also, I think, as you have seen in the discussion today, there are certain policy directions that, if we're made clear in terms even of questions, would allow us to explore one direction or other in a more effective way. So what I would say is that I think we are interested in participating in this debate. Our also students and colleagues are very willing, but perhaps now that we have mapped out the challenges, having an understanding of whether the Scottish Parliament, for instance, has particular questions or ideas, particular opportunities, having a more specific sense of what are the directions for investigation that we could support with evidence and exchange. And then I think, you know, in terms of lessons learned because of the somehow perhaps disappointed answer we just given, the only way to find a good approach is to have a broad-based dialogue where, of course, academics don't just speak to each other, but speak to NGOs, to the other stakeholders, to business, and we have that, we work out together what can work and what can happen and what kind of creative solutions we can all try to come up with. But it needs a bit of a systematic approach, identifying key questions and then giving time frame for us to get together and reach out to stakeholders.
Okay, thank you. Professor Little.
Yes, I would endorse that entirely, and also say I think it's important that the academic contribution is a multidisciplinary one. And that, I think, requires us as academics to think about how that collaboration should be configured. But also I think it requires bodies such as the Parliament here to have an awareness of what that sort of collaborative activity amongst academics and contribution by academics can offer, and also what it can't offer.
Well, thank you very much, all of you, for your contribution this morning. It's been very, very helpful and enlightening. At its next meeting of the committee, it's on the 21st of March, when we'll take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform and the Carbon Accounting Scheme Scotland Amendment Regulations 2017. The committee will also review its work programme and consider its response to the Wildlife Crime in Scotland annual report. As agreed earlier, we'll now move into private session, and I ask that the public gallery be cleared as the public part of the meeting is closed. Thank you.